Happy New Year! This is Chief for Chief Tells Tales. I know it's been a while. I took a Christmas break, so to speak. I got sick over Christmas. Almost lost my voice like I do with every cold that I get. My kids used to make fun of me in the past because they would come around, "Hey, Dad, why don't you talk?" Because that's about as loud as I could talk, was a whisper, and they would just sit there and laugh at me. I watched a video a couple weeks ago, I think it was, and I can't remember exactly what it's fully about, but it was like service members serving together, and someone was kind of, I think, asking them questions about the service, and it's like, why do you guys do what you do with one another, so to speak? And their answer was love. Let me give my two cents about that. It's true. You have a good career, like I did, like my father did. You love the service. You love who you're working with because they're like a family. They are a family. You got many brothers and sisters. Of course, I was the father figure due to my age all the time. Got asked, you know, how it was shooting bow and arrow. And like I said, I tell my soldiers, if you realize the bow and arrow was never a weapon of choice for the military as an issue item. So they would just sit there, huh? Yeah. Then, of course, the other one, you know, asking me about people of the past when they were corporals, serving with them as corporals, and I just laugh at that, too. And plus, being told one time by a Texan that I was older than dirt, and then, like I said, I hurt his feelings by saying, well, if I'm older than dirt, then I'm older than Texas, and he took an offense to that. But he got over it. But it is love. And sometimes you really don't love the soldier or the person that you're standing next to or the service member that you're with, but we don't leave anybody behind, or we try our best to make sure we recover everybody. I mean, now, we did not do that in the past like we are trying to do now. We try to find bodies. We try to take the bodies, dead or alive. Sometimes the dead have just as much care given to them as the wounded to get them back home. And sometimes you gotta sacrifice leaving a dead person behind. It's either a live one or a dead one. So you gotta make that choice. And of course, it's always gonna be the guy that's alive. Never had to make that choice myself personally. I don't know if my father did, because he did serve during World War II. But I'd hate to have to make that choice. Who do I leave behind? And who do I send forward into combat? I'm so thankful I was never in that position. Because you're sending, technically, your family to go fight. And I know some commanders. Well, I served with one battalion where the colonel of that battalion, unfortunately, during his time there, lost 3 or 4 soldiers. I can't remember the exact number. And you could see the pain every time he lost a soldier. And we were not in a combat situation. And I'm not going to go into details how these guys were lost. It's not my place to mention that. And I know, like I said, when I know somebody that got killed in the Gulf War, and then I met the warrant officer who did the research and the report on that helicopter and all the occupants, you can see the pain in his eyes. He didn't even know the guys. He might have known the pilots, I don't know. But we talked about a loss, and then we just kind of looked at each other, because, like I said, there were times throughout the rest of my career, whether I was driving a Humvee or not, I could look over to my right while I was driving, and I could see that kid. I could see that kid. with a big grin on his face, thanking me as a sergeant. I was only a sergeant. I was a buck sergeant, E5. Thanking me for showing him how to put up camouflage. And a few other details that he never got to do while he was in Bravo Company. Sorry. So, I mean, it's love. You remember their faces. I mean, I can look at, I got face, many faces. I'm not talking just about ones that got injured, or I'm talking about live people. I still remember certain people in certain situations, and sometimes you love to hate them as it goes, because I mean, I had, when I was a warrant officer, of course, I had more freedom to be more involved with soldiers' lives than I was as a sergeant, because as a sergeant, yeah, you're counseling them, and sometimes it's like, well, you really can't get involved with them because you can't have that friendship. You can't be a friend to them. You can't be a drinking buddy to them. You can't be a card-playing buddy to them. You're not even supposed to go to their residence, whether they live in the barracks or whether they live in housing. You're not supposed to be that personal with them as a sergeant, because you are in charge of them. So it comes down to make a decision like you don't want to make. You don't want to be in that position. So... yeah, I miss the love. I really do. I really miss the love of the service. And all the brothers and, or actually, my sons, my daughters, my nieces, my nephews, so to speak. After all, I was called the old man. And one of the colonels that promoted me to CW4... said, "Chief, you are the crusty old warrant officer." Because when he and I probably first joined the service, there were older individuals that were warrant officers. Generally, they were in their 40s, maybe in their 50s if they served that long. But then I noticed throughout my career, the warrant officers got younger and younger and younger, because they started pulling them earlier and earlier and earlier, because sometimes some of the enlisted members would go through their career as an enlisted and get into that 15-year mark where you're not supposed to be looked at, the 16-year mark you're not supposed to be looked at. I saw one guy get picked up on his 18th year, I think it was. But he just wanted to fatten his retirement paycheck, that's all. I really miss the service. I just passed my 10-year retirement date end of last year, 2023. 10 years I've been out. Still miss it. Still love it. Really miss it. But Chief, you're in your 70s. Doesn't matter. I don't look like I'm in my 70s. I miss doing PT, to tell you the truth, sometimes. And people laugh. Well, probably would laugh at that. I really do. I mean, sometimes you get lazy. You don't want to do the push-ups or the sit-ups or the run. But, oh well. Don't want to really put this on a downer, but just wanted to put my 2 cents into what I heard the other day, because, you know, it hit home. It really did. And these were younger individuals. And it saddens me that some of these guys that are talking didn't get to serve 20 because they got messed up and were medically retired. And you can tell it in their eyes. Some of them wanted to do that 20, maybe that 20 plus, like I did. Because sometimes when I see airmen and young soldiers and they're sitting there and I identify myself as a Chief Warrant Officer 4, and then I said, I did 28 years, and they're like, ugh! They can't imagine doing that. So, this is Chief. I don't know what I'm going to talk about for subjects for Chief Tells. I'll come up with some things. I keep forgetting to write things down. Once in a while, I come up with an idea, and then it's gone. The next day, I wake up. I should write it down. That way, I got something to talk about. So, also, getting upset with all these people talking about how we keep throwing money over to Ukraine. Like I said before, everything's got a shelf life. The more tanks, the more shells, the more rockets, the more ammunition, the more Stingers, TOWs, AT-4s that we get off the shelves, we get the new stuff. We give them all the old stuff because there has been some. Well, some of these AT-4s were duds. Hey, they were at their expiration dates because black powder dies. That's because if you see sometimes in movies, very rare, you'll see a trigger pull and poof, it's a dud. That means the black powder went inert, so to speak. Didn't have its oomph to go down the barrel. Never had that happen to me, but I know it does happen. So, I mean, the more equipment that we get out of these National Guard motor pools, because sometimes the Army dumps, the active Army dumps, oh, that vehicle over there gives us lots of problems. Let's give it to the National Guard. Let them waste their money trying to keep it working. So that's what the National Guard probably did to Ukraine. Because I just saw the other video the other day saying that they're doing maintenance on the Bradleys, but they can't seem to do the maintenance on the Leopard 2s from Germany. Because they were interviewing a tank unit that had four tanks. Only one of them was working. Because they said these things are breaking down. So maybe Germany did the same thing that everybody else did. We'll give you the stuff that breaks down. Which is kind of dumb in a way. But you want to get rid of your worst stuff first. You want to keep the stuff that's working and running for your own needs. So that's all I'm going to say about that right now. So chief out. Remember, freedom's not free. See you next week, I hope.